Furniture maker and founder of the Center for Furniture Craftsmanship, Peter Korn, this morning to talk about his brilliant new book, Why We Make Things and Why It Matters, with the kind support of the American Hardwood Export Council. Peter will be signing copies of his book in the bookshop after the event, so please stick around for that. Please give him a warm welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much for coming and giving me a chance to talk about this book, which is a subject that's most dear to my heart. And what I'm here to talk about today, which is the subject of the book, is to address the question of why we make things and why it matters, by which I mean the nature of creative work at this particular cultural moment. And of necessity, I'm approaching this topic from the point of view of a craftsman, since furniture making has been the creative work that I've known best throughout the last 40-something years of my working life. And I'll be speaking for about 40 minutes and then taking questions or comments or arguments, and I'd really encourage you to speak, because for me, the most interesting part of these talks is always what other people have to say, and then getting to sort of answer, whatever that is. So where I'd like to begin, and can you hear me appropriately in the back? Yes, okay. Where I'd like to begin is by noting that over the course of my lifetime, it feels to me as if the mainstream of society has come increasingly to think of the individual as an economic unit, and also to hold up fame and money as the only appropriate measures for evaluating our thoughts and actions and endeavors. And at least that's certainly true in my own country. I don't want to speak for yours. But I'd say that that seems to me as an observer to be the case in pretty much every other developed nation where corporate capitalism is the driving form of economic organization. Yet anyone who follows a creative passion, and I know that describes quite a number of you in this room, knows that fame and money are completely inadequate as yardsticks for measuring the emotional, intellectual, and psychological rewards of following a creative enterprise. And neither do fame and money seem to work very well as foundations for living an individual life that's truly rewarding. And I see a lot of examples of this because I run a school in Maine, and about a quarter of what we do are summer workshops, which are mostly attended by middle-aged men. And then we run a lot of longer workshops that are attended by a more gender-balanced and younger group who are studying to be professional. But certainly in the workshop session, we have students come from all over the United States and all over the world, many of whom are already quite successful in life by normative standards. But yet they're spending all the time and money to travel to Maine to make little hardwood benches with dovetails and through tenons. And they're certainly not coming because they need those little cherry benches they're making. They're coming, I believe, or I have observed, is because they have a hunger for some sort of meaning and fulfillment that's missing from their ordinary lives, successful as those lives are. And they have a hunch that by learning to make things well with their own hands, they'll find that deeper meaning or some part of it. And in many cases, that's exactly what happens, which is a wonderful thing. So really what I'm discussing today, having said all that, is I'm discussing the nature of creative work in the context of a question that was quite common to my generation, and that was the hippie counterculture of the late 1960s. And no doubt it's a question that still burns hot for young people today. And that question is, what is a good life, and how the heck do you go about living one? In my case, my brief trajectory has been that I was fortunate enough to be able to go to a Quaker secondary school in Philadelphia where I woke up. I'm still trying to wake up. That was a true Freudian slip right there, I'll tell you. Where I grew up. And the lovely thing about that school is they really placed an emphasis on teaching you to think independently. And then I majored in history at the University of Pennsylvania. And all the time I was in school, I felt like I was living life at second hand. I didn't know where real life was, but it certainly wasn't where I was. It was out there somewhere. And after college, I moved to a quiet, then remote and forgotten island off the coast of New England called Nantucket, which has since become a playground for the super wealthy. And the first job that was offered to me was as a carpenter. I would have taken a job at an insurance agency. I just needed a job. And I grew up in a family where my father was a lawyer and my mother was an historian. And in their social world, they didn't know anybody who worked with their hands. So I didn't know anyone who worked with their hands. I'd certainly never met a craftsman. And my father was horrified by my new choice of work because he was quite clear that, from his point of view, carpentry as a profession would leave me mentally stultified. It would be a life that would not challenge all my abilities. But for a young man of 20, carpentry was a wonderful way to grow into adulthood. It was, pretty much anything I could say about it now has become a cliche, I guess, which is that to be able to go in and do a day's work and at the end of the day's work see that you've achieved something in the real world that was measurable, that was so different than anything I'd done in my life. And to start having a sense of trust in my own hands and develop skills and have a feeling of competence, that's a wonderful way to enter adulthood. And also, I found that carpentry has a tremendous amount of cognitive problem solving in it, and it is not it's not stupid work. It actually takes quite a bit of intelligence as well. So it was a wonderful thing. After 2 years as a carpenter, I made a cradle for some friends who were having a child. And for that cradle, I had a picture in a book. I got some pine and dowels from the lumberyard. I went into an unheated old barn at the end of November. I froze my butt off. But 3 days later, there was this beautiful object that had just started as intent. And then there it was in the world. And that was transformational for me. Because on a carpentry crew, you work with other people, you work to the boss's standards. It's not as independent and it's not as expressive. And once I made that cradle, I quit my carpentry job and I just wanted to learn how to make what seemed at the time like the lost art of furniture making. Because this was 1974, there was no Fine Woodworking Magazine or any other woodworking publication in our country. There was only one place you could buy mortise gauges, for example, and those were imported from England to a little store in Boston. And I got a book by Charles Hayward, an Englishman, woodwork joinery, and I started teaching myself woodworking. I was a self-employed furniture maker for 12 years. I got better at making furniture, but I was terrible at making a living. And after 12 years, I gave that up and I took a job as the program director at a nonprofit school in Colorado called the Anderson Ranch Art Center. Then in 1992, I moved to Maine to start a school for reasons I'll explain shortly. And that school has grown into the Nonprofit Center for Furniture Craftsmanship, which is a wonderful place that I'm really privileged to be associated with. So that's been the course of my life. The seed for the ideas that I explore in this book was something that happened in 1990 when I was at the Anderson Ranch. And to explain it, I need to say that for the first 6 years of my career, I sold my work through craft shows. And then around 1980, I started showing in fine arts galleries. When you show in a fine arts gallery, you have to write an artist statement. And what I was writing at the time was that I was trying to make furniture that had the qualities of integrity and simplicity and grace. And those words actually still describe my goals as a furniture designer. 10 years later when I was at Anderson Ranch, an art critic from New York was visiting named Arlene Raven, and she ran a weekend seminar for myself and the other program directors where we were to write what she called artist mission statements. And in the course of writing that statement, I realized that the reason I'd become a furniture maker in the first place was that I thought by getting good at this craft and practicing it, I would cultivate more of the qualities of integrity and simplicity and grace within myself. And that led me to see, to me quite clearly, that my personal reason for becoming a craftsman and practicing a craft was really self-transformation. And thinking about it, I've come to believe quite strongly that in today's world, the reason people practice all creative arts is first and foremost as a process of self-discovery and self-transformation. And in this talk, I'm going to read a number of passages from the book where I said things better than I can verbalize them standing here. And so right now, I'm going to read three paragraphs from a chapter called Second Epiphany, which relate to what I just said. So, although Anderson Ranch offered workshops in both traditional craft and fine arts media, its board of directors and program staff tended to embrace the prevalent values of the contemporary art world to the detriment of the sort of craft that I practiced. On balance, they subscribed to an ethos that celebrated novelty and elevated the conceptual, while it denigrated utility, beauty, and skill. Within that hierarchy, the instructors I invited for my program, including Alan Peters from England, who was the person I looked up to the most, were considered stodgy and regressive. My truth was different. In my gut, I knew that woodworkers who design and build one-of-a-kind functional furniture and potters who throw utilitarian teapots and dinnerware are as likely to be exploring, expressing, and prescribing for the human condition as painters and sculptors. The revelation of the Raven Seminar provided the intellectual foundation I would need to explore and articulate that position. The critical point, as I began to see it, was that all people who engage in creative self-expressive work, visual artists, craftspeople, writers, composers, and others, participate in the same essential human activity as a woodworker does at the drawing board and the bench. None of us enter our studios because the world desperately requires another painting or symphony or chair. None of us takes the work lightly either because it entails too much commitment, discipline, and risk of failure. Those who choose to do it professionally, except for the very few who reach the top, could find more effective ways to earn decent livings. The simple truth is that people who engage in creative practice go into the studio first and foremost because they expect to emerge from the other end of the creative gauntlet as different people. One of the great things about craft as a creative form is that it roots the craftsman's imaginative life in material reality, or as I like to put it in just a few words, you can't bullshit a chisel, okay, right? Either a joint fits tightly or it doesn't, and it's immediately apparent to any viewer, let alone sitter, how comfortable a chair is. So you know, your ideas are constantly checked with and attuned to the real. As a craftsman writing what is essentially, from my point of view at least, the philosophy of art, it was really important to keep my ideas tethered to the real as much as is possible. And so, in writing, I've tried to ground the ideas I'm discussing in history, science, sociology, anthropology, but most importantly, in my actual lived experience as a craftsman. And there were a lot of lines of investigation I followed, but there are two that I'd like to discuss here. One of them is that I traced the origin and evolution of the idea of craft itself because I wanted to better understand what it is I'd been buying into without even thinking about it when I first picked up a mallet and a chisel in 1974. And the other line of investigation that I'd like to discuss here is to discuss how the ordinary work of designing and building furniture can be a profound exercise in thinking about who we are and how we should live. And so as to the first, I was quite surprised to learn that the idea of craft as everyone in this room understands it, which is a category of object or as an approach to fabrication, only came into existence in the 1870s or so with your British Arts and Crafts movement. And it was invented by the ideologues of that movement, of whom the ones we know best in the US are John Ruskin and William Morris. And prior to that time, the word craft in the English language had been used primarily to denote a capacity for shrewdness or manipulation, which is the way we still hear it in words like witchcraft or statecraft. What Ruskin and Morris and the other ideologues of that movement did was they invented craft as an approach to fabrication because they wanted to find an alternative form of production to the perceived evils of the Industrial Revolution. And they were particularly concerned about the effects of the conditions of labor upon the moral and spiritual welfare of the laborer. Their craftsman at that time was a skilled employee who would build someone else's design through from start to finish in a healthy work environment and could take pride in his work. 80 years later, or 100 years later, when I came to woodworking myself, I had never met a craftsman, and I never thought about craft or what a craftsman might be. But you can bet that in my head there was this Hallmark card-like image of the craftsman as a skilled tradesman, secure in the knowledge of his hands and the strength of his character, calm at the workbench, pursuing a simple, peaceful life in idyllic surroundings. That image was a direct inheritance of the arts and crafts movement. But for me and the tens of thousands of people of my generation who all migrated into craft at the same time, there had been a subsequent overlaying of that idea because my generation came to craft as an opportunity to be self-employed, to be self-expressive, to be self-sufficient, and to be self-actualized, the telling word being self. And that was an approach to craft that Ruskin and Morris would not have recognized. What had changed over those intervening 100 years was there had been a tectonic shift in the normative way that each of us, that individuals in society think of themselves as individuals and where they think the boundary is between the self and the social organism. And I'd like to read a little bit, three paragraphs about that, if I may, from a chapter called The Inward Migration of Truth. Four paragraphs. Ruskin and Morris founded their notion of craft on the assumption that the means of production affected the moral development of the worker, and that the objects produced affected the moral development of the consumer. Theirs was an outward orientation. They thought of the individual as a cell within the body politic. Their ultimate concern was the health of the social organism. In contrast, practitioners of studio craft turned inward to focus primarily on their own emotional and spiritual growth. For them, the self was independent and self-sufficient, and the goal of life was to seek fulfillment from within, to maximize their interior capacities for creativity, feeling, experience, and achievement. To the extent they sought to make the world a better place through craft, they did so by discovering and sharing their personal inner truths. This inward migration of truth is evident not only in craft, but in all visual arts. Artists are products of their social environments. What they choose to portray and how they go about it often betrays what matters most to them. Consciously or not, they invoke the place where truth resides at their particular cultural moment. For example, classical Greek sculpture sought to capture an ideal of human beauty and perfection that existed outside of time, independent of the individual. Medieval Christian art largely conveyed the contents of the Bible. Renaissance art took on secular themes as individuals turned to secular institutions for identity. 19th century painters such as J.M.W. Turner and the members of the Hudson River School, who portrayed the raw majesty of the natural environment, were informed by Enlightenment ideals, which found truth in nature, ascribed natural rights to the individual, and enshrined the ideal of the noble savage. Late 19th century Impressionists painted the world as it might appear to the eye of an idiosyncratic viewer. They made individual perception, rather than external reality, their true subject. Tellingly, by the time studio craft emerged, 50 years after the rise of Impressionism, and studio craft is my craft movement, abstract expressionists were shunning representation of the external altogether. The artists now divined truth entirely from within, as each brushstroke, mark, drip, or splatter registered his internal response to its predecessors on the canvas. The resulting abstract image was neither more nor less than a self-referential record of one person's inner creative exploration, a portrait of his intuition. This was the zeitgeist that gave birth to the contemporary practice of craft. From the start, the hallmark of studio craft has been the motivation of its practitioners to seek identity, fulfillment, and meaning from within through creative, self-expressive work. The second line of investigation I want to share will be briefer, but it's my effort to explain how the actual practice of craft works as a process of exploring existential ideals, ideas of self and society. And for this, I'm going to read three paragraphs from a chapter called Thinking with Things, where I talk about the making of a particular desk 30 years ago, which is the desk at which I still write, and where I describe the making of that desk as an effort to arrive at a vision of how life could and should be lived. Okay. There were three critical aspects to this effort: discovery, embodiment, and communication. They seem to define the essential structure of all forms of creative practice. Discovery is the process of coming up with new ideas and implementing them decision by decision. Embodiment is the way in which the constructed desk cast my decisions in concrete, became what the painter Chuck Close has referred to as the frozen detritus of the artist's experience. Communication is what happens when the desk registers on the consciousness of a respondent. Design was discovery from the first tentative sketch to the hundreds of aesthetic choices I made during the desk's construction, such as deciding how far the top should overhang the sides or what the arc of the stretcher should be. What was I discovering? I was thinking my way visually with materials and tools rather than with words toward an object that would reveal the nature of a good life. Furniture, after all, is more than an object of contemplation, it's a prescription for the life to be lived around it. All the world may be a stage, but for the most part it comes preset with inherited props. The furnishings among which we play out our lives, a Sheraton dining chair, a print of Monet's Water Lilies at Giverny, a Hummel figurine, a Kenmore refrigerator, express the time-bound perspectives of the people who made them, just as they may reflect the prejudices, passions, and predilections of the person who owns them. They are cues that convey meaning, shape our identities, and provide us with a sense of continuity. Inescapably, we are beings for whom objects have spiritual weight. A single piece of furniture articulates a point of view about life on many levels, and I'm just going to give you one of them now. As an aesthetic whole, it positions itself within a thick cultural narrative of style and meaning. Thus, this particular desk, with its streamlined traditional form, absence of hardware, natural wood, overt functionality, and exposed hand-cut dovetails, speaks of both Shaker and modernist design precepts. It orients the contemporaneous respondent, consciously or not, to the Shaker view that domestic life and work should be lived as sacraments. At the same time, it connects them to the ethos of design icons, such as Charles and Ray Ames, Eero Saarinen, Alvar Aalto, and Marcel Breuer, who embraced modernity and whose work spoke to new horizons of human potential. Writing the book was very much, that for me, that same process of discovery, embodiment, and communication. And it led me to, trying to ground it, led me to examine and challenge and change many of my own long-held assumptions about how the human mind works. And one of the things I've come to see is I had always assumed that thought required, that you think with words, that thought required language. And I've come to see that we think with materials and objects at least as much as we think with words. In both cases, the thought seems to take place at a level of the mind that's invisible to self-observation. And that stream of thought that we can't see employs words or materials the same way that a mathematician might use chalk on a blackboard, which is to say it's to keep ideas that otherwise are evanescent and disappear immediately present to observation and also to make them available to others. That's what words and materials do when we think with them. And what convinces me of this relationship between thought and language is there are so many times a day when I know exactly what I want to say, but I don't have the words for it. If I'd been thinking the thought with words, they would have been there. And the other thing that convinces me is how wordlessly I'm exploring ideas when I have a pencil and a piece of paper and I'm sketching. The words aren't any part of it, but there are ideas. Writing the book also caused me to revise my self-conception that I'm an intellectually, of the extent to which I thought I was an intellectually independent, autonomous being. I still feel like a completely autonomous individual being, as I know everyone in this room does, but rationally, I really get that about 99.99% of what goes through my head is not mine. It's just stuff from the society around me that sort of gets stuck in there and that I choose to allow, perhaps, to be in there. And the way I see things is that one thing that brought that home was coming to see how a certain idea of craft colonized my mind purely through the accident of being born into a certain time and place and culture. And that idea of craft would have been far different if I'd been born 50 years earlier or if I'd been born today, because it's changed during my lifetime in ways we might address later. The way I've come to see this is that we're born into a river of ideas that's flowing through time. And we splash around in it for a while, and then we die out of it. But hopefully, we've made some tiny little positive contribution to that river of ideas going forward. And those ideas not only reside in the minds of individuals, which is the primary place they are, but they're also reside in the built environment from which is where we place them when we make things and from where we absorb them when we interact with things. That built environment includes the clothes we put on every morning when we get up to help verify our own persona for ourselves as well as to other people. And it includes public architecture. It includes everything. I'm going to read now three paragraphs from a chapter called Mapping a Craftsman's Mind, where I discuss a little further the ideas I've just presented. Within my lifetime, it was commonplace to picture thought as a completely ethereal phenomenon. Now science tells us that every new idea or piece of information reorganizes neural pathways within our brains. This makes the transmission of information from one person to another a physiological process, comparable to the spread of a virus. Like all living creatures, we cannot shut off sensory intake, and we are acutely receptive to data from our own species. We are so finely tuned to nuances of expression, carriage, speech, and dress that it can take only a glance to accurately place another person in a highly complex sociocultural context. Thus, when you and I interact, your words and actions cannot help but leave a physical imprint on my mind, which may in turn affect my thoughts and actions in ways that are likely to impact still other people's neurons in the future. Ideas and beliefs are hopelessly contagious. So here's how I think things actually work. The information, ideas, and beliefs with which each person constructs his mental map from early childhood on are ladled out of a cultural stew particular to his time and place. He seasons these shared stories with his own experience or combines old ideas in new ways to invent fresh understandings that automatically feed back into the social network. In this way, cultural evolution takes place exclusively in the crucible of the individual mind, although it is in fact a collective phenomenon. Looked at one way, I operate with a unique mental map and have remarkable latitude of invention within it. Looked at another way, my mental map is so porous to those of other people that I function largely as a cell within an encompassing social organism. Like the scientific model of light, I am simultaneously particle and wave. As regards the question that I set out to explore in the book, which is understanding the nature of creative work within the context of what it is to live a good life, the answer at which I've arrived is that a good life is one that provides the person living it with a sufficiency of meaning and fulfillment. I think those are the things we're really hungry for. And meaning is the sense that one's thoughts and actions make a positive difference in a larger moral sphere. Fulfillment is the sense that you're using your human capacities to the fullest, like an engine firing smoothly and powerfully on all pistons. And the most effective source of meaning and fulfillment that I found and that I observe in other people is when we're engaged in the difficult, challenging work of bringing something new into the world out of our own imaginations in a way that will matter not just to ourselves, but also matter to others. And that can happen in the craftsman studio, the artist studio, but that can happen in the science lab, in starting a business, that can happen in your own kitchen. I've used craft as the focus for what I'm writing about, but what I'm really trying to say is engaging in some form of creative work or creative practice is what I feel makes the difference in how one's life goes in that way. And I'd like to read from a chapter here called The Heart of the Ordinary. Creative practice is a way to proactively challenge and refine one's beliefs on an ongoing basis. I would think this is what Socrates meant by the examined life, and this is precisely what ordinary creative work does. A craftsperson, painter, composer, poet, or choreographer sets out to bring something new and meaningful into the world. He manipulates his medium, be it wood, paint, sound, language, or the human body in previously untried ways to tease that meaning into being. The result is novel first-person experience that inevitably extends the boundaries of his mental map. Crucially, when I became a furniture maker, I was searching for a good life and a rewarding identity, but I didn't know what a good life would look like or who I would become. Here, I think, is the hidden miracle at the heart of the ordinary in every field of art. Creative work is an experiment through which the maker seeks new ways to envision human potential using himself as the laboratory, or laboratory, if you prefer. This may sound too grandiose to describe daubing a landscape, pecking out free verse for next month's writer's group, or for that matter, making a dining table. Nonetheless, however minutely we may be absorbed in our own stuff, through creative practice we are investigating existential questions, such as who can I become and how should I live? This subtext gives our actions meaning within the most encompassing of all moral contexts. However humbly, we are participating in the ongoing communal project of mankind to narrate what it means to be human, how our universe works, and how we should live. Stephen Dedalus expressed this memorably at the close of James Joyce's Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man, when he said, "Welcome, O life. I go to encounter for the millionth time the reality of experience and to forge in the smithy of my soul the uncreated conscience of my race." The beauty of craft, because I am shilling for craft here, is that it is such a holistic way to exercise this capacity. As a craftsman, I explore the possibilities of my being and character through discipline and creativity. I root my understanding of my own nature and the world around me in earthly soil, wood, clay, metal, glass, or any other material, with the genius of my own two hands. The things I make boldly embody my thought process. They are accessible to others through touch, use, and contemplation. They communicate ideas that address essential questions of who we are and how we should live. When people talk about art, they generally are discussing it. They're generally discussing either the social functions of art, like how it uplifts people or binds people together, or what its history is through time, the social functions of art and artist institutions, or today they're discussing art as a commodity. But it's important for clarity in discussing, in this discussion we're having, in this, any discussion of art, to recognize that there are three distinct contexts in which one could frame a discussion of art. The one that's clearly been of most interest to me is the motivation and experience of the artist in creating the work. But the other two contexts, which I've also addressed in the book, are the direct experience of a respondent who's personally engaged with the work, and then also the life of the work as it's represented secondhand by others in the marketplace, academia, and the media, using words and images. And I want to read, this is the last reading I'll do, and this is from a chapter called The Creative Cycle. Before writing this book, I passionately believed that craft and art originated with the maker, and that whatever vitality they possessed was the result of his creative focus. Now I see the maker as an extension of society, a cell within a larger organism. The issues with which he wrestles are not his alone. They are every man's. He participates in the conversation of his field and the broader conversations of his culture. The current of ideas passes through him and returns to the body politic with whatever charge he puts on it. To the extent that the maker's ideas are relevant, they pass from person to person. Other makers, academics, critics, merchants, collectors, and the general populace, each one potentially adding his own charge until finally the current returns to the maker or the next generation of makers in the form of a new cultural orthodoxy with which to wrestle all over again. Through this dynamic cycle, the conversations of craft and art in all three contexts first person hands-on making, second person visceral response, and third person abstract consideration through words and images open doors to new perceptions and new narratives, lead to greater fulfillment for the individual, and have the potential to advance society. And that is why I think that we make things and why it matters. And I have one thing to add, which was when this book was at the printer, the first edition, which was in the US a year and a half ago, I reread a book that I hadn't read since it came out in the early 1970s, mid-1970s, which was Ernest Becker's The Denial of Death. And in rereading it, I realized to what a tremendous extent the ideas in that book had been a springboard for my own further thinking. And when I got to the last two sentences of Becker's book, I realized that they were the perfect start for my book. And so they are now, what's that thing called that comes before the book? The APA? Well, it doesn't matter. I lost the word. And what Becker wrote was, "Who knows what form the forward momentum of life will take in the time ahead, or what use it will make of our anguished searching? The most that any one of us can seem to do is to fashion something, an object or ourselves, and drop it into the confusion, make an offering of it, so to speak, to the life force." And that's my presentation. Thank you. I'm really hoping that there's some arguments or questions or comments. Yes, right here.
I'm interested in what you say, and I understand about the fulfillment of making things, but the nature of craft, surely isn't it more about function than philosophy? Aren't we, when you built your desk, weren't you deciding how big it needed to be, where you needed storage space? Wasn't the drive, the function of it, more than the I understand the satisfaction you got from it, and you want it to look nice, I get all of that, but was the real driver the functionality of it?
Oh, absolutely, and in fact, if functionality weren't the driver, it wouldn't be as much of a prescription for the life to be lived around it. It's not just the aesthetics that make the prescription, it's one's attention to functionality. So for example, in the studio furniture movement, in contemporary craft, There has been a lot of work made for galleries that's more conceptual in nature than practical and difficult to use well. So you could have teacups that drip or jewelry that makes holes in your neck, right? Things like that. All right, so that is still putting, the person making that is not paying as much attention to function, but that in itself is making a statement about what matters in life and what doesn't. And when you do pay a lot of attention to function, you are often, for example, putting out a point of view that domestic life, as I say, the Shakers, domestic life should be lived as a sacrament, not that you're like trying to be holy all the time, but that it matters how well you live it and the attention you pay to it, and it can be very rich. Yes.
It's wonderful to hear a lecture where I found I was agreeing with practically every utterance, not least the importance of waking up and the notion that making is a system of thinking, just as drawing is. All of those things very much appeal to me. To paraphrase some of what you said, you mentioned that making a chair, it's not only a means to an end, but it can be an end in itself. In other words, the means to the end is the chair itself, and the making can be a means to an end for the person doing the making. And I wondered whether it was in that spirit that the American playwright Arthur Miller turned to woodworking.
I'm completely incapable of answering that question, because I don't know, but I will say that now, I've written a number of how-to books, and now this is not a how-to book. And how-to books are really easy to write relative to this book, because you know what you're going to say. I mean, you make an outline, and then you, once that's worked out, you explain it in more clearly in more words. This book, all I knew right when I started was sort of, my name is Peter Korn. One sentence and one idea leads to another, and it was a process of constantly untangling knots. And when you're writing, there's such a danger of getting carried away with the ideas, and they get completely untethered from the real world. And I think that perhaps a playwright might have liked woodworking, because it does, as I said, keep you tethered. Yes, right here. No?
Oh,
yeah, go ahead.
I've got it.
I'll repeat it. Oh, go ahead.
I've got it here, sorry.
Then we'll come here after that.
I notice there's a difference between someone like yourself, who perhaps I might describe as a master craftsman, where you've mastered your craft or, you know, working on that. And myself, I'm what I might call a serial craftsperson, where, you know, the driver for me is to just create something new. And I might try felting or glassmaking or pottery or crochet or whatever it is. And once I've kind of made something, I want to make something different. And I just wonder if you had any thoughts on that as a process.
Well, only that what you're doing is exactly what I'm trying to describe, which is to say, what is the drive that takes you to try to keep making something new? And what I'm trying to write about in this book is to somehow explore rationally what it is that makes that exploration, process of exploration, so interesting to you. And I feel like, sort of reiterate what I've said, it seems to me that the major thing we do in life every day from birth is we construct and maintain narratives that so that we can have a story of who we are and how the world works around us. And we can't function without those narratives. And the more accurate those narratives are as templates for reality, the more likely we are to achieve the results we want in life, the goals we want, and the more likely those goals are to be beneficial. And I think that we don't even see ourselves doing. It's like a duck, and you don't see little feet paddling furiously underwater. Well, we work so hard every day to construct and maintain those narratives of self, because for the most part, the world either doesn't care about them, or there's so many things in the world that contradict our narrative. So if you have a particular religion, there's a whole lot of other religions that have contradictory narratives, right? You actually are working. Mentally, it's hard work to maintain your own narrative. The clothes we choose to put on are, as I said earlier, part of establishing that narrative. When you go in the studio and you try different things, you're learning about yourself as much as you're learning about those materials. And so you are, in a sense, extending your understanding of who you are and also how the physical world works around you in ways that may look pedestrian, from a certain point of view, but which I'm saying aren't pedestrian at all. They're really important. I had this gentleman here.
Yeah, I'm an architect, and I'm very, very interested in craft, in architecture, not in just the process of architecture, but also in the buildings that are produced. And in my lifetime, the computer has more or less completely taken over the process of producing drawings and architectural thought. And I was wondering what you felt about the computer, whether you saw it as a threat or an opportunity to developing what you're interested in.
Well, a few things to say on that. I love that question. First is, I keep a small boat in the harbor where I live, Rockport Harbor, and I noticed about 10 years ago someone had a motor yacht there that looked just like a floating Nike sneaker, and it was really ugly. Okay. And I realized the reason it looked like that is because they were now designing boats on computers, and that's what the software lent it to you. The tools with which you design end up actually determining a lot of the look of what you make. As regards the incorporation of computer technology into the making process, I look at it as an opportunity. So our school is just this year getting a computer numerically controlled milling machine because they have finally become relatively inexpensive, they're still costly, so that they're starting to be used in small professional shops, which means that we have a duty to make those available to our students who are going to be professional is one more tool in their arsenal. We took a while to get it because my favorite maxim, if that's the right word, is the early bird gets the worm, but the second mouse gets the cheese. And so as far as the CNC stuff, we didn't jump right on the bandwagon. We wanted to see how it was going to be used. And in fact, when I go to shows like the International Contemporary Furniture Fair in New York, I see a lot of people who are coming out of design schools whose idea of design is that you do it on a computer, you punch a button, it comes out the other end on a machine, right? The things they make are pretty sad, honestly. I mean, that's such a limited way of handling the material that it's kind of dumb design in the sense of mute, you know, dumb. So what we're doing is we're trying to say, how are you going to combine the use of CNC equipment with the hand skills that woodworkers have been working with for thousands of years and the machinery we've been working with for 100 plus years, and get the best out of each thing to get whatever the result is that's desired. I hope that starts to answer the question. Well, I'll take one from this side of the room, yes.
My husband's very lucky to have been able to take early retirement. And he's mentioned several times wanting to make some furniture, do some furniture restoration, but never sort of got round to it, and I'd love him to do that. We've just had extensive building works that have constantly gone wrong, and his self-esteem is really, really low.
I have to interrupt. I'm actually having a lot of trouble hearing you because having been in a wood shop for a certain amount of time, my hearing isn't the best. But what is your question?
My question is, I recognize he's going to be very worried about failing, that what he makes isn't going to work. And I know you've talked about the process being more important than the result.
May I talk about failure?
That's not how he sees it. You know, he's going to say it's going to go wrong, so he won't embark on it. Do you have any suggestions?
I do, yes. So there's a sociologist named Mihai Csikszentmihalyi, which if you look at the name, that's probably not how you pronounce it. It's a tough one. But he wrote a number of books, one of which is called Flow. And put this in my book as well. It's that incredible experience when you're involved in creative work where you disappear for great lengths of time and the work's just happening. And it's a wonderful feeling. And his argument is that that's why creative people do creative work, is so they can, in a sense, plug into the drug of flow. And which I don't agree with, but flow is one reason, and it's wonderful. All right. He gives 10 conditions that are required for flow, and one of his conditions is there's no fear of failure. And I think he's so wrong about that. He's right about everything else, but I think he's wrong about that. Because I know that when anyone is working in the workshop, failure is one end of our compass. You know, you're thinking about every single thing you do in, is this going to work or isn't this going to work? We make mistakes. We make them all the time. Somehow you get to a place, I know my friend Tom Keeley will agree with me, where you just don't really mind making mistakes. I mean, you just expect you're going to screw up. Is that not you, of course. But
I'm not sure I agree about the mind bit here. You get used to it.
You get used to it, really. It's a learning experience. And that sounds trite, but it's so true. Yeah. Yes.
Well, Rena, I have two questions. The first is, apart from not cheating people, what does integrity mean? The second is this. You've created two things, I think. One is the furniture that you create, and the other is that you've written a book. Now, one involves material in the, you know, substantial material, and the other doesn't. So I wonder what the difference is for you in the creative process.
Yes. I'd like to say that from my point of view, the thing I've actually worked the hardest on creating has been a school. which I've given the last 23 years of my life to, and they've been incredibly rewarding. And I look at all three of those things as different types of creative endeavor, each with their own satisfactions. The craft is the most directly, immediately satisfying, because you see what you do, because it's concrete, because it engages, it does engage that, you know, the whole person. So your hand and your skill is as involved as your mind and your imagination. Not when you're sanding a set of six rocking chairs, okay? There are dull moments in craft, but in general, that's the way I would describe it. Writing is actually the thing I now enjoy most. And I think it just suits me better as I've gotten older. And I love the slow untangling of problems. When I'm writing, it's a slow process. Like when I wrote this book, I'd had an impetus to explore this idea about craft as a process of self-transformation. I'd had that for years. I had that idea in 1990, and I didn't start writing the book till 2005, because I said to myself in 2005, if I only write one word a day about this, I'll be ahead of where I was not writing at all. And for 5 years, I wrote at least one word a day. And at the end of 5 years, I had a manuscript, and I had averaged 35 words a day, which tells you that I'm not going to make a career as a writer, okay? I'm not going to go further with the answer, but I actually detail the differences in the book to some extent. I'm not going to call on you, Tom. I know, yes.
You chose not to show us any images of things that you've made. Was that a conscious decision?
Yes. The first time I wrote the book, there wasn't a word about me in it. It was just a book of exploring the philosophical ideas. And I showed it to a friend, an acquaintance, who was an appropriate audience for it, and he was so clearly bored by it. And he didn't say it, but it was so obvious, right? So I realized that I needed some sort of narrative structure and also something to ground it in the real, as opposed to just being theoretical. So with some reluctance, I actually put my own story in there, and that meant putting pictures of my work. But I wanted to put as few into the pictures of the work as possible, because I didn't want it to be a book about my work. My work is reasonably good, but I run a school where about 40 to 50 other people teach every year. And this is a true statement that almost every one of those 40 to 50 is a far better furniture maker / craftsman than I am. I'm a guy who for the last 23 years, I've taught a lot. I may make one piece of furniture a year, but I run a school is mostly what I do. And so I only teach the introductory course, which is the one I wrote the textbook for. And other people teach the things that they're doing every day. We have 1 minute. Yes?
What do you think of the desk next to you, and would you teach from it?
What do I think of the...
The desk next to you, and would you teach from it, or would you make it different?
The lectern? All right, well, I get a hard time. When people come in my office at the school, I'm working at a desk I made, and then my computer is on a plastic laminate commercial holder, and I'm perfectly happy with that. I'm not all picky about the furniture, actually. I just admire beautiful things when I can have them around me. And that's it. We're done. There's just 21 seconds left officially, but thank you so much.